Je travaille donc je suis. Even though René Descartes might not appreciate this transmutation of his legendary philosophical insight, certainly those who understand the centrality of labor to all social processes recognize that work and thought are dialectically interrelated. Si je suis parce que je pense, je ne peux pas penser si je ne travaille pas. And of course, this is not an individual or individualistic process, but rather it is a deeply social and thus collective process. I'd like to thank Professors Margaret Marouani and Daniel Mulders and Jacqueline Lofer for having invited me to participate in this important international colloquium that marks the 20th anniversary of L'Hommage. And I'd like to thank the president of the Université Paris Descartes for having hosted this event. I'm happy to join the many scholars who will be presenting today, sociologists, economists, geographers, historians. It seems that I may be the only participant trained in philosophy, but I should point out that my framework, critical theory, is an interdisciplinary one, which centers questions and problems, and which embraces insights from many disciplines and genres. I cannot begin without acknowledging that this colloquium takes place in the city of Paris, which remains in a collective state of grief following the attacks almost exactly 3 weeks ago. I'd like to add my own condolences to those that have been offered by so many people from throughout the world. I also want to point out that the last time I was in Paris, last spring, to engage with issues surrounding immigrations and the current refugee crisis, the Loi sur les renseignements had just been passed. And I remember that I expressed my hope that France would learn from the very difficult history of the post-September 11th passage of the Patriot Act in the United States. 14 years later, we are still grappling with the repressive consequences of that legislation. And I must say I was somewhat distressed to learn that the mass march and demonstration urging immediate intervention with respect to climate change was canceled, which raises the burning question, who are the ones who bear the brunt of emergency measures that are represented as increased security? The lines of empty shoes at the Place de la République symbolize that even as we attempt to protect our lives from terrorism, we must be ever vigilant in the protection of our rights and liberties, the rights and liberties of all, including people of African, Middle Eastern, and Asian descent, and especially now, given the many immigrant women and men who are fleeing political and economic violence in their home countries. A major problem confronted by researchers who study women's economic activities around the world is that not only is information regarding poor women's presence in the labor market incomplete, and this is especially true of the global South, but scholars working with labor statistics are often not able to take into consideration a plethora of women's jobs that are situated outside of the formal sector. Historically, women's work has been materially and ideologically segregated from the labor market. Feminist scholars have attempted to understand this phenomenon by offering the framework of the public-private distinction, which helps us to understand why women's economic agency has for so long been confined to the private sphere. But of course, this has not prevented women from playing important historical roles in organizing labor movements in the public sphere, which have benefited men as well as women. But even when women's work is situated within the capitalist productive process, It has been perceived as being closer to reproductive than productive labor. So for my remarks, I would like to focus on reproductive labor, on paid domestic and caring labor that becomes even more necessary when middle-class women enter the labor market and are compelled to hire other women to perform the domestic task of reproductive labor. I have chosen this topic not only because it has been a consistent theme of feminist analysis for the last four decades or so. I remember the Italian wages for housework movement in the 1970s and interventions by Selma James and Maria Rosa Dalla Costa. But I have to say that I was somewhat opposed to the notion of wages for housework, but that's another story. But also, I've chosen this theme because it permits us to apprehend the racialization of gendered labor, and more generally requires an interdisciplinary approach and an intersectional analytical framework. On the occasion of International Women's Day this year, Guy Ryder, who is the Director General of the International Labor Organization, emphasized, and I'm quoting, "Globally, only half of the world's women are in the labor force, compared to nearly 80% of men, a figure basically unchanged in 20 years. A larger gender pay gap hasn't narrowed much, with women still earning on average 23% less than men. And new evidence is emerging that mothers suffer a wage penalty, often over and above the gender pay gap." Ryder continues, "The percentage of women in top management and in positions of political leadership has improved. The percentage of women who work as self-employed or unpaid family members has declined. But women remain overrepresented in low-wage employment. One of these low-wage areas is domestic work. On a global scale, some 53 million people work as domestics. And of course, the majority of them are women. In 1958, pioneering Senegalese filmmaker Ousmane Sonban was struck by the predicament of African domestic workers when he read an article in the newspaper Nice Matin about an African maid who had committed suicide. In 1972, he published a short story in a collection entitled Voltaïque, Le Noir de et Autres Nouvelles, La Noir de, Trois Points de Suspension, also became the title of his first film, which importantly was the very first feature film from sub-Saharan Africa released in 1966. The main character of the short story and film is Diwana, a Senegalese woman who finds work as a domestic for a white French couple who, for the time being, live in Dakar. When they return to France, they ask the worker, Diwana, to accompany them. Diwana imagines this invitation to live in a beautiful home in the Mediterranean, in Antibes, as a miraculous opportunity to escape the impoverishment of her life. However, after she arrives in France, she slowly begins to realize that as a domestic worker, imprisoned in the home of people whose attitudes toward Africans are entirely shaped by colonialism, she is little more than a slave who can find no way out of her predicament. She is totally isolated from her family, from friends, from anyone who might sympathize with her. She decides to take her own life. Literary scholar Dana Ushowitz points out in an essay published in the anthology Ousmane Sonban and the Politics of Culture that, and I'm quoting, "In the short story, Sonban is careful to tie Diwana's death to the end of empire and the beginning of the Fifth Republic. Tijuana's death takes place in Antibes on the French Mediterranean coast, 3 weeks after Charles de Gaulle was granted emergency powers to stabilize the French government in the wake of rising violence in Algeria and the collapse of the French Fourth Republic, as well as the referendum on colonial independence. In the story's opening paragraph, the narrator remarks that, quote, neither the destiny of the Republic nor the future of Algeria or the territories under colonial rule was on the minds of those who were on the beach at Antibes. There were other consequential historical events that took place around that time. 2.5 years before the African Maid's 1958 suicide took place, the suicide on which Somban based the short story in the film, the bus boycott in Montgomery, Alabama, for which Rosa Parks' courageous action served as a catalyst, and which, of course, catapulted Martin Luther King to fame, that boycott had just come to an end. There is a connection to be detected between the suicide of an African woman domestic worker in France and the success of the Montgomery bus boycott, which dramatically demonstrated that Black people in the US were prepared to struggle for justice and full equality. That connection resides in the still largely unacknowledged fact that Black women domestic workers played a central role, central and dramatic role in rendering the Montgomery bus boycott a success. These domestic workers were not hidden, solitary, and isolated, as was Somben's character, and as the job itself usually dictates. Rather, they forged a powerful community of struggle that became a crucial and determining moment for the mid-20th century Black freedom movement in the United States. At the beginning of the 20th century, US Black women constituted 28% of domestic workers, but by 1950, they were 60% of all domestic workers in the US. Almost 90% of Black women workers in the southern states of the United States were domestic workers. Almost every Black person of my generation in the US can discover family links to domestic work as one of the many ways in which slavery attempted to reinvent itself. My mother, for example, would not have been able to pay for her education, her high school and university education, had she not found jobs as a domestic worker. Looking at the extent to which domestic workers' efforts to organize and fight back were thoroughly entwined with the development of the Black Liberation Movement helps us to understand not only the ways in which women workers' efforts can create better conditions, not only for themselves and their sisters, but rather also how the movement of those who are at the bottom of the economic hierarchy can leverage larger and radical changes in the social world. In examining the importance of gender in the economic sphere, it is essential to recognize that gender is always classed and gender is always raced. The heuristic value of what has come to be called intersectionality cannot be underestimated. While we can celebrate the spectacular changes in women's work over the last half century, the relegation of domestic work to the margins of our concern about women's economic activity is laden with historical and contemporary structures of racism, xenophobia, and heteropatriarchy. Historian Primula Nadesan has just recently published a book entitled Household Workers Unite, the untold story of African-American women who built a movement. This is a book that was published this past August. And her research emphasizes the importance of valuing domestic workers and their organizing efforts. It is a part of the untold history of the United States labor movement. And I'm quoting from her text. Domestic workers played a significant and complicated role in the Montgomery boycott. They filled the pews at the mass meetings and served as foot soldiers that made the boycott a success, and they exhibited leadership by raising money and mobilizing others in the community to support the protests. They used their domestic skills in the service of the protests, and the political leverage they gained from civil rights activism in their day-to-day dealing with their employers. The disruptions of the boycott transformed their relationships with their employers, emboldening them and fostering a sense of militancy. In this way, they used their occupation to aid the boycott, and the boycott to wield leverage with their employers. The history of militant activism of domestic workers has been relegated to what Foucault calls subjugated knowledges, so that despite self-directed efforts to organize labor unions, and despite dramatic participation in larger community struggles, the contributions of domestic workers have been largely ignored. In the United States, already in 1881, in Atlanta, Georgia, some 20 black laundry women came together to create a union, which they called the Washing Society. Incidentally, this was the same year as the founding of the Federation of Organized Trades and Labor Unions in the United States and Canada, which 5 years later became the American Federation of Labor, as in AFL-CIO. As historian Tara Hunter points out, the Washing Women's Society called a strike in order to establish uniform wages, but they also made an explicit demand for respect on the part of their employers. Within 3 weeks, and this is documented in the local newspaper of Atlanta, the Atlanta Constitution, within 3 weeks, some 3,000 laundry women joined the strike. This strike emboldened other black women domestic workers, cooks, maids, nurses, hotel workers. And this, one can say that this spectacular strike, about which very little has been written, it's only been recently addressed in the work by young historians who are attempting to do social history from below. But this spectacular strike marks an important moment in the history of women workers and in labor history more generally. There have been many efforts to organize domestic workers in the United States, from Dora Jones, founding of domestic workers, the Domestic Workers Union in Harlem in 1934, to the National Domestic Workers Alliance, founded in 2007, which is directed by Ai-Jin Poo. The racial composition of domestic workers in the U.S. has shifted over the last decades, as African-American women, still concentrated in low-wage jobs, have moved into other areas of the economy. Working class black women are now playing major roles as labor union leaders and organizers, especially in such campaigns as the drive to force the world's largest corporation, which is, of course, Walmart, to give their workers a living wage and the benefits they deserve. They're also very prominent in the effort to create a $15 an hour minimum wage across the country. The contemporary multiracial and multinational ranks of women domestic workers, and more broadly, workers in the what is generally known as the caring economy, reflect the globalization of capital and the waves of immigration that have accompanied these developments. The newly republished book by Grace Chang, which is entitled Disposable Domestics, Immigrant Women Workers in the Global Economy, demonstrates how transnational analyses of reproductive labor are critical to an understanding of race and gender today. I might also mention Rachel Salazar Pareñas's 2001 Servants of Globalization, Women, Migration, and Domestic Work. Today, inside the U.S., the ranks of domestic worker and care labor workforce consists largely of Latinas, Asian Americans, and new African, Caribbean, Asian, and Eastern European immigrants. However, the structural problems of racism, the concomitant disrespect, and the lack of labor protections, the lack of labor protections persists. As the Domestic Worker Alliance points out, domestic workers, quote, perform the home care work that makes all other work possible. Domestic work is the work that makes all other work possible. You might be interested to know that one of the three founders, one of the three women who founded the Black Lives Matter movement is also a leader of the Domestic Workers Alliance. Her name is Alicia Garza. Feminists who are concerned about the incorporation of women into the labor force, and of course, Ingalls long ago made the argument in Origin of the Family, Private Property, and the State, that this would be key to women's emancipation. Feminists who are concerned about women and the labor force should also be concerned about those women who bear the brunt of reproductive labor. I spoke earlier about the feminist approach of intersectionality. Prevailing citational practices generally point to legal scholar Kimberly Crenshaw and sociologist Patricia Hill Collins, who have both produced works indispensable to feminist studies that have introduced the analytical approach of intersectionality. However, it should be pointed out, and both of these scholars agree, that the most interesting genealogies of intersectionality take into account what one might call epistemologies of praxis, and thus trace this concept also to activist efforts to address such issues as race, class, gender, nation, and sexuality together. Certainly, the history of domestic worker organizing helps us to understand how it became necessary to explore the interconnections among class, race, gender, sexuality, and nation. The ideological significance of domestic work as women's work, as reproductive labor, is also linked to the historical development of imprisonment as the dominant mode of punishment. When women's prisons were introduced in the U.S. in the 1870s, They were represented as reformatories, places where women criminals could be rehabilitated into better wives and mothers. For poor women, and especially black women and women of color, this meant rehabilitation by learning the skills of domestic work. Whereas men were putatively to be rehabilitated into better citizens, and prisons, of course, never succeeded in doing this. Feminist reformers argued that women criminals who had been considered irredeemable, completely fallen, that they could indeed also be reformed. But they were to be relegated to being made into better, not better citizens, but rather better wives, mothers, and servants. They thus learned in prison how to wash, iron, sew, cook, and other domestic skills. Until the 1980s and the booming prison economy that was associated with deindustrialization and the rise of global capitalism, and of course the dismantling of the welfare state, women's prison architecture even reflected this domestic approach. And the cottage model was a specifically female architectural model used in many prisons across the country. Women in prison should actually be considered a part of the eligible labor force. It is true that prisoners work, men and women prisoners work, often for private corporations, but for the most part, had they been able to find fulfilling jobs or had access to education, they would not be in prison in such large numbers. And parenthetically, it should be remembered that, at least in the US, I'm not sure about here in France, unemployment statistics never reflect prisoners. Today, there are over 200,000 women in US prisons. Now, this might seem a small number given the fact that the entire prison population in the US consists of almost 2.5 million people. But during the 1970s, the entire prison population in the US hovered around 200,000. So now there are as many women as there were women and men in prison 40 years ago. I think you're already aware of the fact that over-incarceration practices in the US have led to the imprisonment of more people than anywhere else in the world, both more in absolute numbers and more per capita. The US has 25% of the entire planet's incarcerated population, but only 5% of the population at large. What is interesting is that the more than 200,000 women in prison in the US constitute almost 1/3 of the documented female prison population in the entire world. That is to say, 1/3 of all of the women in prison on the planet are in prisons inside the US. The countries that have the next highest women prisoner population are China, which has 84,600 women behind bars, and Russia, 59,000. Of course, it is impossible to understand the dynamics behind the rapid growth of the prison population for both women and men in the US without considering the impact of structural racism and the profit-generating role of what has come to be called the prison industrial complex. It is only now that established political figures are recognizing, are beginning to recognize the extent of the prison crisis. But even so, over-incarceration is not necessarily recognized as structural state violence. Its corporate dimension has not been recognized. Neither are the increasingly publicized police killings of Black people acknowledged as emanating from the structural racism of state repressive apparatuses. Moreover, these crises are largely seen as only affecting men. However, women constitute the fastest growing sector of the prison population, and they are also persistent targets of state violence. Transgender women of color constitute the most criminalized community in the US. Trans women, particularly trans Black women and trans women of color, are attacked, killed, and imprisoned with impunity. Both domestic labor and incarceration practices are highly racialized. The majority of women domestic workers are women of color. The majority of domestic workers are women, and therefore the majority are women of color. Likewise, women of color constitute the majority of those in jails and prisons. While this correlation refers specifically to the United States, in Europe, Latin America, and Australia, similar racialized dynamics can be discovered. Both domestic labor and incarceration practices with respect to women should be central to feminist agendas in the 21st century. But they are largely ignored in mainstream feminist efforts to guarantee the incorporation of women into economic and social processes. Domestic work represents the historical ideological relegation of women to the domestic sphere. It represents the historical privatization of women's work. Because capitalist economies do not recognize the reproductive labor that enables productive work, this work has been devalued both as uncompensated and as paid labor. Given the histories of the US and Europe, domestic labor bears the inheritances of slavery and colonialism, and the racial hierarchies that continue to remind us that slavery and colonialism have not yet been successfully relegated to the past. The US punishment system, which serves as a model for jails and prisons all over the planet, recalls the violent practices and racist deprivation of rights associated with slavery. The systematic marginalization of women in prison who are disproportionately women of color should be of special concern to feminists. Of the many contributions of feminist theories and practices to our scholarly and activist strategies, I wish to cite this one as I conclude. It is often the case that the greatest and most productive insight emanates from what appears to be the smallest and most marginal problem. So it is with domestic labor, without which no other labor is possible. So it is with women in prison, whose predicament reveals the dramatic failure of our capitalist, profit-driven societies to provide for the welfare of their citizens. Thus, I conclude by saying that the great challenges of the 21st century are to recognize the extent to which the racism emanating from racism and slavery, from colonialism and slavery, pardon me, the extent to which they continue to influence contemporary socioeconomic developments, especially with respect to women, and therefore to simultaneously forge strategies that will allow us to finally begin the long-delayed process of purging our societies of the still active vestiges of colonialism and slavery. Thank you very much. Merci beaucoup.